Every morning, billions of us reach for the same dark habit, myself included, an alkaloid ritual strong enough to rewrite our sleep, sharpen our focus, and change our blood work. It's praised as a longevity elixir. Monks once brewed it to outlast prayer, empires taxed it, and factories scheduled breaks around it to increase workday productivity. 2025 dropped new clues, signals in the heart, the liver, even our genes, that say the way we drink it matters more than we thought. The myths behind coffee have hardened into a ritual that rewrote our mornings. October 1st is officially International Coffee Day, and although you're listening to this episode on October 2nd, I'm here to update you on how 2025 updated the blueprint to coffee. Long before lab assays and hazard ratios, there were stories. One tells of an emperor in ancient China whose boiling water caught a drifting leaf, tea, and with it humanity's first brush with caffeine. The purported story of coffee comes centuries later, around 800 AD, from a cherry red berry in the highlands of Ethiopia. A herder watches his goats dance after nibbling the fruit. Curious, he tastes. Nearby monks are given the berries and brew the seeds to hold vigil through the night. Word spreads across deserts and seas. Bitter tonic that keeps the mind lit, even when the sun goes down. Names, dates, even places shift with the telling, but the feeling is constant. A small molecule in a bean bending human wakefulness toward purpose, and containing many more molecules influencing us in ways that we are only beginning to understand. Coffee didn't begin in a mug. In East Africa, people packed mashed coffee cherries with animal fat for portable energy, and only later did the seed, the being, become the actual star. When the practice crosses the Red Sea into Yemen around the 10th century, Sufi communities brewed a bitter decoction to hold vigil throughout the night. Wakefulness turns from happenstance into liturgy, then from liturgy into habit as markets and homes adopted the ritual. For a long time, it was used as medicine rather than daily comfort like we use it today. Something you take for focus, for a headache, for stamina, until trade routes and roasting know-how standardized the process of making coffee. By the time Europe fully woke up to coffee in the 18th and 19th centuries, the drink was essentially an information network in a cup. Coffee houses stitched together finance, science, gossip, and dissent. They also offered boiled, safer alternative to questionable water, nudging societies from drinking ale in the mornings to coffee and clear-headed mornings. Of course, the rush is not innocent. Plantations, enslaved labor, and sugar sit behind the bittersweet ascent of modern-day coffee production, and later, the factory coffee break was used as a way to increase workday productivity. As Michael Pollan quips in his book on caffeine, it became part of baseline consciousness. You feel it most when it's missing. Underneath all that culture is chemistry doing the heavy lifting. Coffee is pharmacology in a cup. A small pervasive molecule, caffeine, surrounded by hundreds of companion non-nutrient molecules. Caffeine's move is simple and clever. It blocks adenosine's slow-down signals in the brain, easing the brakes on neural circuits so attention feels snappier and mood feels steadier. That disinhibition also lets dopamine and serotonin pathways ratchet up in activity, which is why the habit feels both useful and rewarding, but the same dose isn't the same body to body. Most of the cleanup happens in the liver via cytochrome P450-1A2. Some of us run that pathway fast and clear caffeine quickly. Others run it slow and hold on to it for hours. Fast metabolizers tend to tolerate more and often drink more because the stimulant fades sooner. Slow metabolizers feel the trail, lingering alertness that can edge into jitters, sleep disruptions, or blood pressure bumps if the day's cups pile up. Sensitivity isn't just the liver either. Variants in the adenosine A2A receptor via the ADORA2A gene help explain why a modest Americano makes one person pleasantly focused and another a bit anxious. And on the reward side, genes that tune dopamine and serotonin signaling like BDNF, SLC6A4, DRD2, DAT1, COMT, those shape how satisfying that cup feels, which quietly trains the habit loop. There's also a social amplifier. Coffee is contagious by design. Coworkers brewing in cafes on every corner, In that environment, the genetics of coffee liking and tolerance express more strongly what researchers call a feedback between context and heritability. In plain terms, the more your world encourages coffee, the more your biology actually leans into it. So the story arcs from caravans to cafes and from monks to mitochondria. History explains why the drink is everywhere. Biology explains why it feels different in each of us. And that brings us to the real question for 2025, given what we now know. How do we brew, time, and tweak the cup so it consistently works for our heart, our liver, our sleep, and our day? Given the newest data in 2025, what actually changes in the way we drink it? Three signals stand out: timing, what's in the cup, and how it's brewed, and they map cleanly onto sleep, cardiometabolic risk, and cholesterol levels. The first major study of 2025 we're covering looked at timing coffee intake. A large analysis in the European Heart Journal reports that coffee's survival advantage is carried by morning dominant drinking. The sip all day pattern loses that association after adjustment. Placing the dose in the morning aligns with circadian cortisol and adenosine dynamics, like lifting weights when the gyms actually open, while late day cups push stimulant load onto your sleep window. So the takeaway would be to concentrate your 1 to 3 cups before noon rather than grazing through the afternoon. Study 2 focused on what's in the cup itself. A U.S. cohort of 46,000 adults linked coffee to lower all-cause mortality and cardiovascular disease risk, unless you add enough sugar and saturated fat to drown out the benefit. Think of polyphenols, melanoidins, and caffeine as the signal. Sugar and cream can be the static that cancels that out. The practical takeaway is obvious: black or lightly doctored keeps the advantage. Heavy sweeteners and creamers, they likely erase it. The third study was about filtration. Diterpenes, cafestol, and coagol are potent LDL-raising compounds that paper filters largely remove. A study this year sampling workplace coffee machines found many outputs with higher diterpenes than paper filter drip, implying that what you drink at work may be subtly nudging cholesterol the wrong way. Paper filters are like fine mesh sieves. Metal meshes are like garden rakes. More slips through. So lean towards paper filter drip at home and, if possible, at work. Treat French press boiled metal mesh espresso as occasional. 2025 brought one of the cleanest data sets we've seen yet. In the UK Biobank, over 170,000 adults followed for 12 years. Unsweetened coffee was linked to a 25% lower risk of chronic liver disease and about a 40% lower risk of serious liver events, with the sweet spot at roughly 2 to 3 cups a day. But add sugar or heavy artificial sweeteners, and that protection disappears, sometimes even flip the risk entirely. The idea is that liver benefits belong to clean coffee and not highly doctored coffee. So what do we make of all of it? Coffee's story runs from myth to medicine to modern science, and in 2025, the evidence gave us a clearer blueprint. The new data points in 4 directions. First, timing matters. Coffee's survival benefit is tied to morning drinking. Front load your cups before noon, if possible, because the all-day sipping pattern seems to lose its edge for most people. Second, what's in the cup matters. Black coffee or lightly doctored coffee keeps its protective signal, but add enough sugar or heavy sweeteners and the advantage disappears. Third, how it's brewed matters. Paper filters catch diterpenes like cafestol that raise LDL, while unfiltered methods and even some office machines let more slip through. And finally, the liver story. Around 2 to 3 cups of unsweetened coffee per day was linked this year with a lower risk of chronic liver disease and fewer liver-related events. So coffee isn't just ritual. It's a molecule, a method, and now a matter of evidence. And the 2025 blueprint shows us that how you drink it is just as important as how much, which means the next time you reach for that cup, you're not just chasing alertness. You're making a choice about long-term health.